So it was really around 2010 when a group of several different organizations coalesced here in San Miguel. And we'd all been working on different international development projects around the world. And the one thing that all these organizations had in common is that we were really seeing the limitations of our impact. And so we came together looking for a better way to do this work. And we designed some really simple foundational concepts, some simple philosophies to help guide us on our way. The first is that we just decided that we're gonna live where we work. Instead of being disconnected in an office in New York City, we're gonna live in a specific region that we're trying to impact and try to create solutions and technologies for that region. We developed the skin in the game philosophy, where we're gonna develop technologies that we ourselves use in our own daily lives. And the third philosophy we developed was that we decided we're not going to enter communities directly. Instead, we're going to partner with grassroots organizations, community leaders, and instead of going in with an agenda, we were going to go in and listen and see how we could help support. And so that's really how CADIS Mexico was formed, which is the precursor to Caminos de Agua.
And it was really a phase where CADIS was trying to figure out, was dreaming about what kind of sustainable technologies to bring a foundation, bring more information to San Miguel and the region.
So it was in about 2011 when we were invited to participate in CODESIN, which was a coalition of grassroots community organizations and dozens of rural communities who all came together to work on the water crisis. And we saw pretty quickly how we could help support that effort. There had been some water quality studies done in the early 2000s and in 2006 that had uncovered excessive levels of fluoride and arsenic in the water. And we needed new data. And so we started reaching out to all of our university partners, hydrogeologists, and that's when we started a relationship with Northern Illinois University and then later with Texas A&M University.
Desde el 2012 nos dedicamos a monitorear en conjunto con las universidades la calidad de agua de nuestra cuenca a través de monitoreos en los que encontramos resultados alarmantes de arsénico y fluoruro, y un ejemplo es el de arsénico en alguna comunidad por encima de la norma de la Organización Mundial de la Salud más de 22 veces.
Pues aquí, gracias a los estudios que se hicieron en el 2011, más o menos, sabemos que el agua de aquí tiene altos niveles de fluoruro. De hace poco supimos también que tenía arsénico. Este tiempo en el que estamos pasando, pues es sobre explotación de nuestro acuífero. Uno lo que más le duele es cómo a uno de comunidad te dan tan poquita agua cuando a las grandes empresas tienen demasiada y demasiado gasto. Que uno no sabía el por qué los niños tenían la dentadura café, que era, pues sí, que era mal higiene, y empezaron a hacerse que limpiezas, pero la sorpresa fue que una vez que se hacían sus limpiezas, se les caían pedazos. Mucha de la población, de que ya era gente adulta, mucho padecimiento de dolor en los huesos. Y ibas al doctor y el doctor decía, pues es artritis, es, o sea, enfermedad, reumatismo, o sea, cosas así.
And so within the coalition, within CODESIN, we in Caminos de Agua, we were out with university partners testing water quality throughout the region. Our other grassroots partners were working with the human rights attorney to gather witness testimonies on the health and economic impacts that the water contamination, as well as the water scarcity issues, were having on people and communities throughout the region. And the whole point of this is that we built a human rights case that we ultimately presented in front of the Permanent People's Tribunal in 2013.
So, you know, just building a case, some of the nuts and bolts of what you actually have to do is you have to go out and you have to document the facts in the field. And then how do we package that all together so that we have a comprehensive complaint that we can file before the hearing body? Seeing the auditorium actually packed with, my gosh, I don't remember how many people we had. We had hundreds of people there, you know, coming from all over the community. And we had planned that at the hearing, that we would have a moment. It was Lucha who was presenting. She would invite everyone present to manifest by standing up their identification as someone who's impacted by the situation. A chill went through me when I saw just the number of people who were standing. That moment still popped up and still stands out for me.
So it turns out arsenic and fluoride is incredibly difficult to remove from the water. And so it got really depressing really quickly, just giving people bad information without any tangible solutions. And these contaminants are so difficult to remove that it was actually just easier to look for an entirely different water source. So that's when we turned to the rain.
Rainwater is good in a couple of ways. One is it's a source of sufficient water if you can build a cistern to collect it during the rainy season. And two, rainwater doesn't have toxins like fluoride and arsenic in it. So combine that with a ceramic water filter that takes care of pathogens and you have pure drinking water.
Y cuando vi a Dylan con este filtro, pues a mí se me hizo bien porque dije, pues está bien porque es para ayudar como a la gente que no tiene como muchos recursos. O sea, este filtro para filtrar el agua está muy bien, ¿no?
Entonces empecé yo a consumir el agua de lluvia. Y para mí, en lo que fue en mi persona, yo empecé a sentir el alivio en cuanto a mis dolores, porque yo era una de esas tantas personas que tenía que vivir con unas pastillas. Pues era algo que no se había visto, o sea, muy, no sé, muy bonito a la vez, porque como que era un aliento de vida.
So it was around that time in 2014, 2015, we were continuing our water monitoring program. We had started our rainwater harvesting program in earnest, and we'd also started developing our ceramic water filter. And so we all kind of collectively woke up one day and realized we're a water organization. And so that's when we decided to make the name change from Cadiz, Mexico to Caminos de Agua.
So when I arrived at Caminos de Agua, through years of collaboration with community organizers, it had been doing a ton of work on rainwater harvesting and had identified this need to develop a filtration system to remove arsenic and fluoride from groundwater because rainwater harvesting was just too expensive to implement everywhere quickly.
We were putting every cent we had into rainwater harvesting and it just wasn't sustainable. So we really worked on building structure and professionalizing the organization.
My job was to build this system to remove arsenic and fluoride from groundwater and then we would make it available for everyone. So my role very, very quickly changed from doing technology development myself to building a team, trying to figure out how to make a low-cost, accessible, zero-electricity system to remove arsenic and fluoride from groundwater.
We exploded from about two or three staff members in 2015 to 10 full-time staff, as well as a growing network of technical fellows, interns, and volunteers who are really helping support the mission and move us forward.
One thing that really, me llamó mucha la atención in Caminos de Agua was the way that Caminos collaborates with communities that are already organized. I have worked with so many organizations that say, we know what is best for you, so here you go. And I just have so much respect for the way that Caminos starts every interaction by building relationships with community organizers, with promotoras, with folks in civil society, folks in religious society, and listens, especially, and acknowledges our own role as outsiders. And listens and listens and listens and tries to figure out what the actual need is that our unique set of specialties can work to meet.
Yo creo que la comunidad es el principal actor al que todos los demás tienen que ver para apoyarle, para fortalecerlo, para darle las herramientas. Pero sí, una comunidad necesita otros involucrados que vengan a fortalecer el proceso, sobre todo pues, en algo que es tan difícil como es este tema del agua, ¿no?
El cómo nos acercamos con las comunidades, cómo interactuamos con esa vida a nivel comunitario, pues implica una responsabilidad también porque en esas interacciones también tenemos que dignificar la vida de las personas, tenemos que dignificar la vida de las comunidades y la tecnología tiene que ir en ese sentido.
Working with Caminos, certainly at the beginning, was a very interesting experience for me. What I found was this really incredibly smart group of people who were very committed to the mission of Caminos de Agua. And here we are with this band of enthusiastic, idealistic young people has turned into a professional organization. That has really strong expertise in many different areas, and now including the ability to raise the money to do the work that the organization needs to do.
So we've never been able to do this work alone. We've always relied on our grassroots community partners, community coalitions and organizations and community leaders to really help implement these solutions in the field and also help educate people on the problems.
It just seemed like a very great opportunity from my perspective because I could kind of just fulfill a specific kind of technical role, you know? I can help with some of the research, I can help with designing experiments and collecting data and understanding the data and help them to understand better the data they're collecting. And, you know, all the other people at Caminos are doing the really hard stuff of like interacting with communities and planning and coordinating and understanding how everything fits in with the culture.
Al estar con las demás organizaciones, pues es algo que nos ha ayudado mucho también porque la experiencia que se ha tenido pues nos da más fuerza también, pues no podemos solos.
Las personas decían, bueno, sí, nos cuentan de esa problemática, pero ¿quién nos va a ayudar a tener con qué hacer esas cisternas? Y bueno, son muchas de las cosas que nos fortalece el estar unidos. CATIS o Caminos de Agua está en San Miguel, pues nosotros estamos acá en San Luis de la Paz, pero es una sola cuenca y sobre todo también podríamos, al estar unidos, ir como visibilizando esta situación y dando propuestas a las autoridades, propuestas de soluciones más económicas, digo que sí son más económicas, más reales, más prácticas, más que sí le llegan a la gente, porque comprar agua de garrafón a 42 pesos no era una solución.